Please welcome Virginia Matthewaite, AWS ML Hero Data Squad team lead at Teamwork. Since 2017, she has been leading the Data Squad team at Teamwork, focused on data and artificial intelligence. Their purpose is to make the most of their clients' data via data science, data engineering, big data, mainly on AWS. After earning PhD on natural network and reinforcement learning, Virginia taught AI for over 10 years to master students. She published 5 books. Her last book was about machine learning implementation in Python with SkyKit Learn. Please ask your questions on Slido and Virginia answered them after the speech. Virginia, please welcome and stage is yours.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. And I'm very happy to be with you tonight. So good evening, everyone. I'm sorry, I don't speak Ukrainian, so I cannot tell you good evening in Ukrainian, but I would like to be able to do that. So we will be able, we will speak about data lab approach, like the moderator has said before, and we will go from zero to hero. So what do you have to do a data lab and why this subject? In fact, you can see a lot of big companies that are all saying the same in all newspapers in the world. They want to be data centric. And it is something that is very interesting today to see that every company wants to become data centric, to take better decisions from the data that they have. And so they want to use this data that they have, but they don't know really how to do that. And how to do that, it is something like climbing a mountain. You want to go on the top of the mountain and you are on the lower place and you want to go there. You don't know how to do that. And the data lab is exactly that. It is a path to go from down to up the mountain. And so you will be able to climb that mountain and to go from your traditional approach to a data-centric one in your company. And so we will go and see how you can do that in your company, for example. So as it was said before, I have a PhD in artificial intelligence. I taught AI and other languages, programming languages for years. I wrote books and now I work for Teamwork. And what I'm doing in Teamwork is helping customers to use their data the most as they can. And so we are helping a lot of companies to create data labs, to manage their data labs, and to go to realize their data lab projects and to build them and to run them and to monitor them and so on. So we are working with them on the data lab approach. We are not doing only our data lab. We are doing data labs for a lot of companies. And so what is a data lab? So the definition of the data lab is it is the small labs that make the big projects. And what is important is that a data lab is a data laboratory. So it is a lab. A lab, it is somewhere where you can try things, where you can experiment new things, where you can do innovation in a very agile way. And so you will not have to be and to do all the processes that you have in traditional companies. And so you will be able to act very fast in this kind of projects. Of course, the sentence is maybe not one of Aristotle, but it is my personal definition of what it is, of what is a data lab. And so what is the first step to do a data lab? The first step is to create your dream team, because a data lab is a new team in the company. It is not a small team in another big team. It is not something that you have to put in the IT department. It is not something that you will put in the business department. It is a new team that you have to create from zero. And in this team, you will have to put everyone who will be useful for your projects. And so you will have to find a lot of different people to create your dream team. The main error that I find in a lot of companies is that they hire one data scientist. Most of the time, it is a junior data scientist. And then they say, oh, I don't know why it don't work. It doesn't work. We don't have a data lab with real project or things like that. Of course, you cannot. If you have to hire only one people, it is not a data scientist, it is a data engineer. Moreover, you have to find someone who has a lot of experience in data projects, because it will have to work a lot alone or only with the team and not with other part to help him. So please don't choose only a junior data scientist. It is the worst that you can do for your data lab. Choose a team with people with experience that will be able to help the other ones and to create projects that will work. New team, new place. You have to find a new place to do your project and to create your data lab. And in some companies, they are doing something that is very interesting right now, is that for the data lab, they are creating a new startup. Why they are creating the startup? It is because the startup will work in a different place, maybe not even in the building where the company is, but in another building, maybe in another town or thing like that. And they will have other processes. They will have very light processes to hire people, to test projects, to find money and things like that. So they will be more agile than a team in a big, big company. So create a new team with some people of experience and create a new team in a new place. So this is the first step that you have to do to start your data lab. Then when you have done that, you have to find a sponsor. Why? Because in a lot of companies, you have to use the money that you will have in the budget. But sometimes the budget is moving during the year. And sometimes in the high positions of the company, they have to choose which projects will be stopped or will be continued and so on. So you have to be in the project that will continue even if the budget is lower than the one that was previously said at the beginning of the year. And so you have to find someone who is very powerful in the company and who will help you to be sure that the data lab will be something very important for the whole company and that everyone in the company will know that the data lab is important and is an important way to go to a data-centric approach and that is important for the futures, for the future of the company, because maybe if you don't make that move right now, you will be dead in 5 years or 10 years. So it is a strategic decision and you have to have someone on your side who can take this kind of decisions. If you can, the CEO is the best person to be your sponsor. But in a lot of companies, you cannot have the sponsor to be your CEO. You will have to find someone else, but always choose someone with a lot of power, and with great power come great responsibilities, as you know. So really find a powerful sponsor to help you for your data lab approach. When you have that, you have a team, you know that you will have money and time. Thanks to the sponsor, you will go to the third step. And the third step is to find all the use cases in the company that you may one day do in the data lab. Of course, the list will change over the time, but you have to start with a very good list of the use cases that you can find. And for each use case, you will have to do an identity card to understand this use case a bit more. So you will have to go to every business unit in the company to speak with people, to look at what they are doing in their jobs, in their life, and saying, okay, are there some painful tasks that you are trying to do in your job? Are there some moments where you think, oh, I don't want to do that because it is boring, because I think it has no sense, or thing like that? And then you have to study this use case, because it is a use case, and to find if it will be a suitable one or not. So you will have to find a lot of information about the use case. You have to find someone who will be responsible about the use case. So it is a business man or woman who knows a lot the use case and will help you to define the use case, to evaluate it, and to know exactly how it is working. You will have to create a small description of the use case, to define what is the difficulty of this use case. Will it be something very quick to do or very time consuming? Will it be very difficult or very easy to do that kind of project? And you will have to evaluate what will be the return on investment. Will you gain time or money with this use case? Is it an important thing on the business unit or not, and so on. So once you have all the information about the use case, you can go and check and find another one. So maybe in just one business unit, you will find dozens of use cases, and you have to document them all to have a list of all what you can do in the data lab. And it will show you that the data lab has a lot to do in most cases. It's just only one project or two projects, but you will have a lot of use cases. So it may be very time consuming to detect all those use cases and to go from one place to the other place and to ask everyone what are the problems, what are the pain points, and how you can help them. But be careful, because if you are waiting that people come to you and tell you what are they pain points and their use cases, maybe they will not do that because they don't know what you can do with data. So you have to explain a lot what is possible to do with data, with machine learning, with data engineering, and so on, because they don't know that. And so if you are just waiting for people to come with their use cases, they will never come, because they don't even think it is possible to do something to help them. And so you have to go and see what they are doing and trying to understand what they are doing and saying, okay, this kind of task, I can help you to do that. This kind of task, I cannot help you. But this one, yes, I can help you. It is very boring for you to do that. Yeah, I can help you. And they will say something like, it's possible? Really? You can do something about that? But I have done that for years and I didn't know that it was possible to do that with automation and data automation and things like that. So yes, you will have to go and find them, and they will not come to you. You will have to go to the use cases. It is very important to do this step also. All the steps are very important, of course, but if you don't find every use case like that, you will lose a lot of maybe very good opportunities to do something. So try to find something. The fourth step is to plan the base architecture for every project. Mainly, you will have the same architecture every time. You ingest data, you store data, you process data, you visualize data, and you will be able to do something around data like machine learning and things like that. So you will have to plan the base architecture of your IT design, and you will have to find something that will be very well done, that will be able to adapt to new use cases, because you will always have new use cases you haven't thought about before, and so they don't exactly match with the base architecture that you have made, and so you will maybe need to add some things around it. But you have to find something that will be able to evolve during the time, and to find the right services if you are on AWS to do that. And AWS is very easy to use for this kind of projects, because you will be able to change one service to another one very simply. And it is more easy to change the service that you are using in AWS than going from one tool to another tool in the software world. So as you use AWS, you have an advantage on this base. Design it, create it, imagine what you can do with it, and how you will be able to evolve, and all the first use cases that you have seen may be put into your architecture. If it is not possible to put any of the use cases that you have find before in what you are trying to do, is that what you're trying to do is false. And so you will have to go back and think about it again and to see which kind of data you will mainly use, which kind of process you will mainly have to do, which kind of visualizations you will have to do mostly, and so on, to choose the right architecture for your projects. Maybe it will be very difficult to do that. Maybe it will be very easy. We have some cases where the architecture is very clear since the beginning of the project, and we are helping some customer with Data Lab, which architecture is in fact very simple, and we use the same services again and again. And we have some other customer where the base architecture is very difficult to find, because there's a lot of constraints, there's a lot of differences between the use cases, and sometimes we are just doing many architecture that we are trying to fit together. So sometimes it is easier than some other times. It depends on the company, it depends on the size of the company, it depends on what the company is doing. For example, in Industry 4.0, you have a lot of IoT, and so you will have a lot of IoT data to ingest. But in other companies, you don't have any IoT, and so you will not use the same way to ingest the data. So try to find that, try to find different ways to do each step, and so you will be able to choose between maybe two or three tools to use at every step in your base architecture, and you will not need to add other tools or other services at the end of the project, because you will have to change everything for a new project that you can have. And the last step is to prioritize the projects. You will have a long list of possible use cases, and you cannot do every use case. Of course, it will be too long to do everything. So you have to choose, where do you start? What are you doing first? And the best way to choose that is to compare the identity card that you have done before. If you have a project that will be very difficult, very time consuming, and we will need a lot of money to do that, and which return on investment is very low, maybe it's not the first project you will have to start with. So mainly in the companies where we go, we are trying to find for the first step a quick win. A quick win is a project that is very easy to do, that is very easy to show to everyone, and with a big return on investment. The main importance for this project is to choose the project that you will be able to show to your CEO or to someone with a high power in the company, and to say, okay, we have 3 months, and in 3 months, we have done that. And so you can see what you will be able to gain with the Data Lab in more months, maybe in years, and so on. Because if we can do that in only a few amount of time, imagine what we can do with a big amount of time, or with more money, or with more people, and so on. And so it is very important to start with something that is very interesting, that is very easy to show to business people and to financial people, and so on, so that they will be okay to continue the adventure that you have started with your Data Lab. And so you will have to go from zero to something that is not hero right now, but the first step is very important. Don't miss the first step. If you miss it, you will have some problems. So please start with a quick win and then say, okay, now we will be able to do some more difficult tasks and to do some more difficult projects and so on. And so prioritize them. One other thing that is very important to do that is to check the availability of the business people who will help you during the project. If you know that in a project A, you will need a business person, and this business person is very, very, very busy and very difficult to speak with, maybe the project will not work. Why? Not because it is a difficult one, not because you don't have the resources to do that, but only because you will not be able to talk with the business person who is in charge of this use case. And so choose a use case where the business person is very available to start with, because it will be easier for you to speak with him, to understand the business case, and to do something that will be very useful at the end. So maybe it is not the best return on investment of the list, but you have the availability of the person. So choose on the return on investment, on the cost, on the difficulty, on the risk that it will work or not, and the availability of everyone who is implied in this project. And choose the best one to start with. And when you have done this one, look at the list and choose the best one that you have in the list, the reminder list, and so on, until you will have only some small projects that are not very useful or not very easy to do, or maybe too difficult for the moment, and so on. And so each time, choose the best project that you can do in the next month, and so on, and you will grow and grow. You will have more and more experience. You will have more and more support in your company because you will have done a lot of interesting things in the past. And don't start with the big project that you want to do, but maybe start with more small projects in the beginning, and maybe after 1 year you will be able to go in the big project that you wanted to go to do since the beginning. But don't start with something too big. Start with something that you will be able to show very quickly, to have more support, more resources, and so on. And then what do? Win and go. You just have to go and do your first project. And to do your first project, you will go to a more technical part, and you will go from the design to the build phase of the data lab. Of course, every X month, maybe every 3 months or so on, you will have to check if you have new use cases and things like that, and maybe to change the priority of the project depending on what is going on in the world, in the company, in the strategic, and so on. So you will have to change maybe a lot of time what you are doing and so on, but choose the first project and go do the first project. And to do that, of course, you can have a great insight to use AWS. AWS will help you in a lot of ways. So AWS is very easy to use to do some data lab approach. And moreover, if you go to the account manager of your company, the AWS account manager of your company, you will be able to speak with him and maybe find some programs. There are a lot of programs in AWS to help you to start projects with money or credits, or maybe a solution architect from AWS who will come to help you with your projects and so on. So you will ask them what they can do to help you, and you will have to go to AWS with what you're trying to do, and they will help you in a lot of cases. And in many of our customers, we are coming with AWS to help them to create the data lab approach. AWS is very useful to start the projects and so on, and We have, in a lot of cases, solution architects that are working with us, or we have some credits to start things and to try maybe services that are a bit expensive and things like that. It will depend on a lot of criteria, so I cannot tell you exactly which program you will be able to use, but ask your account manager what you will be able to use depending of what you're trying to do. Moreover, you will be able to use the AWS services, and there's a lot of them to use for every step. So I will give you my favorite ones for every step in the process and explain a bit why I'm using mainly these services and not all the other ones, because you can do a lot of things with a lot of services, and one service can be used at many steps and one step can be done with many services. So the first step is the ingest collect phase, and so the winners are first DMS. DMS is the main service that I use to ingest and collect the data, because in most of the cases they are in databases. And if they are in databases, it is very useful to use DMS to take the data from where they are to your data lake, because in most cases, when you have a data lab, you will create a data lake or data warehouse with all the data that you can take from the different business units. So DMS, I think, is my favorite one for this step, and it is very useful to use. The second one is the IoT core, because we work a lot with industries and they have a lot of connected things. It can be some sensors, it can be some machines, it can be a lot of things, and so they will be able to send messages to AWS using IoT Core with MQTT for the protocol. And so we are using a lot IoT Core for this kind of projects. Mainly we will have both of them. We will have DMS and IoT Core, because it's not really the same data that you will take from one side or the other side, but you will have in your data lab to use both of them in a lot of cases. My third one is Kinesis. Kinesis is very useful to ingest a lot of data in very small time. So if you have some streaming and things like that that you can use to ingest data, maybe Kinesis will be a good choice. We have used it in the past in some companies, but it's not the most useful that we have for our project. Mainly it is DMS and IoT Core. But be careful, in some cases Kinesis will be very useful too. So you don't have to forget about this one. It will be so bad to forget it. We go to the second phase. It is the store one. Once you have ingested or collected the data, where do you store them? And of course, the winner for the storage is S3. You cannot do a project without S3. I don't know how to do a project without S3, in fact. So I think S3 is the best for that. You can put a lot of data. You can put anything that you want on S3. It can be video, images, sound, text, PDF, all what you want, you will be able to store it on S3. So yes, it is very useful to use. Mainly we use S3 with lake formation. So lake formation will help us to do a data lake to store the data. So these two are working a lot together, but at the end, we will store things in S3. And sometimes when we are not doing a data lake because we have few data or the data model is very clear and so on, we will not use S3 or data lake. We will use Redshift. And with Redshift, you can do a lot of things with very simple steps. So if you have only one or two databases that you are using as source data, maybe you will be able to use Redshift, and we have some Redshift in some customers' data lab. So sometimes it is very useful to use. It is not the main service that you use to store the data, but we can see it in the first free services that we use to do that. The next step is the process step. So how can we process the data that we have stored? Because in most of the times you store raw data and then you will do some processing in on the data to have some prepared data that you will be able to use after that. And sometimes you can have the raw data in S3 and the prepared data in Redshift, for example, or in most cases you will have a bucket for the raw data in S3 and a bucket for the prepared data in S3. And so all you do to go from the raw to the prepared data, we will use mainly Glue. Glue is a very good service to use to do that. It is easy to use. You will have to write a bit of code, but now with the new tools that you can see in Glue, it is easier and easier to do this kind of things. The next thing that we do to do some processing and some querying is Athena. And the last one, maybe it is a surprise for you, it is step functions. And in fact, with step functions, we can do a lot of things. And for example, with IoT projects, we will store the raw data in S3, but we will process the data not with Glue, but with step functions. And in the step functions, you can decide what you are doing and what you are doing next and so on. You can cut your big processing step in many small processing steps, and you will be able to monitor the whole thing and to retry some steps that are failing and to send messages or alerts when you have a problem during the processing phase and so on. So you can do a lot of things with step functions, and I have to say that I love step functions a lot. Next step is the visualization step. And so for the visualization step, the main service will be QuickSight. Some years ago, at the beginning, QuickSight was very simple, but also very limited and with very poor possibilities and so on. But now it is bigger, and you can really do some big things with QuickSight. So it is a very useful tool to use and to look at. I was not very fond of QuickSight because I tried it at the beginning, and now I have to say that it was a mistake, because QuickSight is a very good service to do some things around that. As I have said, we have a lot of IoT, and so Sitewise is also a very good tool to do visualization. It is multi-tenant. You can do a lot of things with it, and you can see hierarchical data and things like that. When you have processed your data, you can send alerts and so on. So you can do a lot of things with Sitewise. And the last one was the Elasticsearch and the OpenSearch project. This service will allow you to do a lot of things, and most of the time when it is not possible to do something with QuickSight or with Sitewise, it is possible with OpenSearch. So you can go from one to another one and integrate one in the other and so on. So you will be able to do a lot of things with these three services. The last step, and after I will be done, it is the enhanced step. And the first one is, of course, for me, SageMaker. I have got a PhD in AI, and SageMaker is the best for that. So SageMaker is the main service to do any machine learning and to do any artificial intelligence on the data that you have. You can use some very easy tools, because AWS SageMaker, Amazon SageMaker is a very, very big service with a lot of tools that you can find inside. You have some very easy tools to use for even non-business scientists or things like that. Even just a business analyst can use SageMaker, and moreover, with the new canvas that was given to us at the last reInvent, it is very easy to do some machine learning without knowledge. And if you have some data scientists who know a lot about what they can do and how they can do it, they can do nearly everything in SageMaker. You have notebooks, very easy to use. You can do some experiments. You can study bias with Clarify. You can create and deploy an API in 2 clicks and so on. So it is very, very useful to do the enhancement part of your project. The second one is forecast, because in a lot of cases, what you have to do is to predict the future from the past. And it is exactly what forecast is doing. So you will predict the sales from the past sales, or you will predict the prices from the past prices and so on. So you will be able to use forecast a lot to do this kind of things. And the last one is Textract. Textract is a cognitive service which is very useful to identify and to extract information from text that are images or PDF. So you just have to give a PDF and it will give you back the text that is inside the PDF and the forms and the arrays and so on. So you will get all the informations from the PDF. You will be able to study it, to maybe store it in another way and so on, or to do searches on content, and you will be able to do a lot of things with all that kind of services. So for the enhancement part, that is mainly machine learning and artificial intelligence, SageMaker, Forecast, and Textract. And so now that you know a bit all that I know about the Data Lab, maybe it is not exactly all that I know, but you have the main facts, you can go to your company and you can start and go create your Data Lab and create your first project and maybe create very good things that will change the way your company is working, because you will be able to give them some very useful metrics to change the decisions and to have a better strategy in the future. So you're building the future with this kind of approach. Thank you very much. I don't know if there are some questions that I will answer. In English, please,
we
not
have.
In Ukrainian, because I don't speak Ukrainian, as I have said. So please, in English.
We will quickly learn Ukrainian during the question answer session. So thank you for your speech. It was really great. I have a few questions from my side, just general one. The first one, before finding the sponsor, probably we need define our use cases, right? We need to create this high-level architecture, probably some return of investments, some ideas, right? Or plans, and then only finding the sponsor, right? We should demonstrate them, hey, we would like to cover these use cases. Here's the base architecture. This is the cost. This is the team. What do you think about it, right? Something like that. So only this flow.
In fact, what we have seen is that if you wait this time to find the sponsor, maybe your project will be closed before you mm-hmm. will have the time to find him. So you will have to find him very quickly to be sure that your project will stay in the strategy of the company. And yes, you have to find at least one use case to convince the sponsor that you will be useful. And most of the time, when you're creating a data lab, you have an idea of what you will be able to do. So yes, you will have to find maybe one use case and say, okay, with a data lab, I think we will be able to do this kind of things, but we need help. We need someone who is mm-hmm. thinking, believing in us, is thinking we can do some great things. Imagine what we can do. Maybe we have this use case and it will be useful and so on. And then the sponsor will say, okay, yes, I will sponsor you because I think it is interesting. And so go and find other use cases to convince everyone in the company. But you have to find the sponsor very quickly to be sure that the Data Lab will not be a project in the next months, years, or things mm-hmm. like that. And it is very quick for companies to say, yes, this is very interesting. Oh, no, in fact, it is not interesting. Go on something else. So be careful with that and find the sponsor very quickly. We have mm-hmm. seen some companies where they didn't have sponsors and the project was forgotten before it has even started. Mm-hmm. So I think it is a pity to see that. And having a sponsor will assure you that you will have some resources to do what you want to do.
Mm-hmm. Like a startup mode, fail fast, right? So just
yes, exactly.
Quickly validate your idea. Yeah.
Why a lot of companies are doing startup to do their data labs, because they know that this way they will be able to fail fast. They are just doing one startup. It is not the company. It is not the company's money. It is not the company's strategy and so on. It is a startup. And if the startup is growing fast and doing well, they will say, oh, it is our startup. But if it is failing fast, so yes, we forget that. We will try again and so on. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe from your experience, is it possible to find some sponsorship from AWS on their resources, etc.? So is it possible?
AWS will help you a lot for this kind of stuff because they love the data lab approach and they have some people who are here to help you doing these kind of things, but they will not be able to be the sponsor because for the company AWS is an external entity, and so AWS has its reasons to do that and to help you, and you have your reasons to do your data lab. So they will be able to give you advices and so on, but they will not be your sponsor because you need someone in the company and not outside the company to be the sponsor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, makes sense. Thank you. We have a lot of questions actually on our list. Yeah, so the first one from Taras. The most voted. What if company is doing SaaS, software as a service, for multiple clients? How to implement multi-tenant data lab and provide different permissions for clients?
It will mainly depend on the services that you will use. For example, for the visualization, if you are using mm-hmm. Sitewise, Sitewise is multi-tenants. So you can very easily use Sitewise to do multi-tenants data visualizations. It will be more difficult to do with, for example, QuickSight. So you have to choose some mm-hmm. services who will allow you to do multi-tenants and so on. And we have some customers working for other customers. And so we are trying to do some multi-tenants architecture. Of course, it is a bit more difficult to do that, but it is possible. And you have services who will be able to do that. And moreover, with IAM, you can control exactly who is allowed to see what in most services, and you can go very fine in the details, so you will be able to choose which customer will see which data and so on. And yeah, with services like Sitewise, it is included in the product, so you just have to use it and to say these people have access to this kind of sensors and so on, and it is okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. The next one. What are the best practices for compliance, like GDPR, for example, and data governance when personally identified information, PII, is used for ML training?
Oh, well, for ML training with personal data, you have to anonymize nearly everything mm-hmm. because it is very difficult to use personal data. Moreover, you have to be sure that the RGPD was okay. So everyone has checked that the person is okay, that his or her data will be used in the way that you will be using it. So be very careful with these kind of things. I don't have any guidelines except take a legal person to show and to be sure that you are okay with what you are doing. And in most mm-hmm. cases, anonymize everything that you can. Don't store things with names and so on if you can. Do that in a separate way and just keep the data without the names, without the address and so on. And if you have to keep them because it is important for your machine learning project, be sure that everyone in the data set is okay that you are using personal data, their personal data for the project, to be sure that you will have no suicide about that And moreover, there is a law in the European Union that will come next year, the AI Act, the Artificial Intelligence Act, and you will have some more constraints on project when it will be machine learning and artificial intelligence on personal data, because there's a lot of things you will have to do to comply with the new law that you will have. So RGPD is one thing, but it's not the only one. We have another thing who will come next year. It is announced for 2023 and applied in 2024. So it is in 2 years from now. So be careful of that and take a legal person to be sure that what you are doing is okay.
Very interesting information. Thank you. I will check after the call.
The reglementation, the AI is something like 100 pages. So be careful when you are reading that, because 100 pages of legal information is very difficult. Take a legal person to do the lecturing and just give you a resume of what you have to do.
Yeah, summary, kind of. All right. The next one, it's kind of interesting one related to architecture, actually implementation. So before we start any lab or real project, there are a lot of unknowns in the ML, you know, and what about this DLC and software development lifecycle and actually implementing these projects by agile methodologies like Scrum or Lean, etc. So did you have such experience when you need commit on some features and you fail, for example, you can guarantee something?
If we know that we are not sure, we are very clear with the customer that it is something that we are not sure we will be able to do. And it is the case for every machine learning project, for example. We never know if it will work or not at the end. So we have to try and to see if it is working or not. And so in these cases, you do the fail fast. So you start with the most risky part of the project. And so the customer is paying only for the days that you have put into the try and fail step. Mm-hmm. And if you see it will be okay, you will be okay to grow the project with some less risky parts until the end of the project with the parts that you know you will be able to do. And in machine learning, for example, we do a lot of iteration. We are working with the CRISP methodology. So CRISP methodology is an agile methodology adapted to a machine learning project. Scrum and Kanban and so on are for development projects, but when it comes to machine learning, you cannot use Scrum. It is not adapted to do that, but CRISP is very easy to use for this kind of project. And we are doing some iteration of something like 2 weeks, so 10 days of works. And at the end of the first 2 weeks, we know if the project is impossible or not. And at the end of the second iteration, we know what we can achieve, like for the accuracy metrics and so on. So we will be able to say to the customer, okay, right now we have 70% of accuracy, but we think we can go over that, or we have just 40% of accuracy. I think we have to stop the project. So you have to stop very fast if you know that you will not be able to do the project. And the CRISP methodology with very short iteration, like 2 weeks, is very easy to use to this kind of project to be sure to stop it before it will become a big fail. So start start quickly, fail quickly, and fail with very short time and very short budget.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, it's like feasibility study, right? So we just need just check quickly. All right. So thank you. The next one, it's a good one actually. I faced the same issue, not issue, but probably your experience here. What do you think about place of ML components in classic Lambda or Kappa architecture for big data, actually, in distributed system?
When we deploy machine learning, most of the time we were using SageMaker. But the deployment with SageMaker was a classical endpoint working 24 hours a day, every days in the year, and so on. And so sometimes we were tricking it by trying to do other ways to have a serverless endpoint, for example, and we used lambdas and things like that to do that, and to have something that is easier to manage, because we don't manage anything in Lambda, in fact, so it is easier to do than in SageMaker. You don't have to choose the instance numbers and to change the instance number during time and so on. You just have to say, okay, I want it to run and go. But doing a machine learning project in Lambda is very difficult because you have a lot of frameworks to import and so on. And so you will have a big size, and most of the time it cannot enter the Lambda maximum size. So we were a bit, what we can do a bit about that, and we had some problems until SageMaker releases the serverless endpoints in the last reInvent. And so from this point, we can use SageMaker to do either classical endpoints or more serverless endpoints, and to be able to treat a lot of data in a very real-time way. And if we need some batch data and to do some cold data to infer, we will create something like a forget or an ECS or thing like that, just to do the big part of the batch transform job to do that. So for the real-time part, we will now use more and more SageMaker serverless endpoints, and for the cold part, we will use batch transform with something that is more fixed and more infrastructure-based, so like an EC2, ECS, forget, and so on, with every library in it. And we hope in the future the size of the Lambda memory limit will be increased, so we will be able to do maybe Lambda 2s, but it is a bit difficult right now to work with that, or step function or thing like that. I don't know if it's the answer that you wanted.
We will ask after who actually created this question. All right, so for me, yes, it's a good answer. The next one, the quick, I guess, do you use Amazon Managed Workflow for Apache Airflow or AMWAA? Did you heard about this?
We use Airflow in some use cases. Most of the time, I'm not the main data engineers implementing these kind of things. I'm more on the machine learning part of the projects. But yeah, we are using the, to automate everything, we are using Airflow in some project, maybe in a lot of projects. I don't exactly have the number of them, but Airflow is the main tool for these kind of things. And sometimes we use some other tools, but I cannot give you exactly the names that we will be using, because it is not really my part in this kind of project. I'm doing the first step, and then someone else will deploy it and maintain it and so on and orchestrate it. And so I'm not an infrastructure guy or a deployment guy and so on. This is not my kind of cup of tea. Sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. It's fair. All right. So probably the last one. We have a few more, but we are almost out of time. So and I will extend it a little bit. So what is the best approach to learn various AWS tools from scratch? And the second part from my side, actually, did you certify by AWS data analysis or professional architects or something like that? So the first part is actually how you learn new tools, and did you certify it?
Okay. The second part is the Azure one. So in my teams, and I've got three teams in my department, and I manage the whole department, we have a lot of people with certifications. We have some machine learning specialty. We have some architects, solution architects, and so on. We have some developers, of course, and so on. But I don't have, you don't have to say that too loud, I don't have any certification on AWS right now. I had one, but it's not a valid one since last year, and I didn't have the time to pass it again, so I have no certifications. But in my teams, and in my company, we have more than 100 certifications, so yes, we have a lot of certification. We are 200 people working in a lot of different things, and only few people are working on AWS, but we have more than 100 certifications, so we pass a lot of certifications. And all we learn AWS, we use a lot online courses to do that, and we do a lot of projects, and so we are integrated juniors in projects where there is a senior people in them, and so the junior guy will learn from the senior person, and it is easier to do that, to learn new things. And so every time we do that, we say it to the customer, we don't sell the junior at the same price than the senior, of course, because the junior is still learning, and we will learn together to do things like that. So the first way is online courses. We use Udemy, we use Coursera, we use some official AWS courses that you can find on the partner on the partner program and the partner website and so on. And we use a lot of experiments and experience with working with people who have a lot more experience than you have to learn from them and to learn their best practices and their guidelines and their some tips and so on that you will never learn in any online course, that you will find working with someone, and the person will be able to say, oh, okay, it's not working this kind because I know that I have to do that, and then it's working. And if you try to do that, you will not find that in the online courses, and you will not find that in some cases in the documentation, because even AWS documentation sometimes it is a bit weird and difficult to understand. And so you are trying to do something that is in fact very simple, but it is not written in the doc. And so if you have a senior with you, it will show you how to do that. For example, some years ago, doing calls with API Gateway was very difficult. Now it is easier to do that, but at the beginning, it was a lot of steps just to allow the calls, and now it is easier. And so we had to look after other people who know how to do that to learn from them. So experience is very useful to do that.
Yeah, I a few years ago when DMS just released, we spent 3 months day to day work with AWS developers, fix their bugs because we had a huge integration from one SQL server to another, and we using DMS, and it was really terrible time. Yeah, not a lot of documentation.
That's right. Every time you have a problem with AWS, it is not in the documentation. Everything that is working fine is in the documentation, but everything that is not working is not in the documentation. I will not say that too loud again because I'm an AWS hero, so I've signed.
Anyway, they had a really great documentation in general.
Yes.
Yeah, in comparison.
There's a lot of documentation. Moreover, there's a lot of documentation, but sometimes there's some small lacks and you have to find someone who is knowing what to do if you don't want to spend hours, weeks, or months on the same problem.
Mm-hmm. That's why we have community who can help, right?
Yeah.
And AWS as well. Cool. So this is right time to define the best question. So what do you think? If you remember some of them, what do you think? What is the best question?
The best question?
Yeah.
Whoa. I think the best question was the one around how do we manage when a project when we don't know if it will fail or if it will be a success, and how we deal uncertainty in this kind of project and so on. So it was a question, but I
Let's define another one because it was mine, probably.
Ah, sorry. I'm sorry, I didn't remember this was yours. I'm sorry. Okay, so I will say it is the last one about how to learn AWS and about AWS services. It's not yours.
No. It's Andrew Protas, if I spell correctly. So just send your email to org team and they will send you presents from Enix. So thank you again. It was a really great speech. Yeah, a lot of knowledge actually to learn. I just make a lot of notes because I have the same actually challenge with the lab. So. Yeah, thank you and have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Bye. Have a nice end of meetup without me because I will not understand. Thank you. Bye. Right.